My name is Robert Greenberg. I'm a composer, a pianist, a music historian, and a storyteller. And I'm here to tell the stories behind some of the music that will be performed by the orchestra this season. This is wonderful music, this concert music. It's music for all of us. And the more we know about it, the more we know about its composers, the more we know about the time in which it was created, and the more we know about these pieces themselves, the more visceral, the more powerful, the more wonderful the experience is. Join me, please. Generally, but accurately speaking, dealing with the mature Johannes Brahms, all 5'1" of him, was like licking a cactus. Brahms's prickliness and downright rudeness were legendary. He was reputed to have stomped out of a soiree in Vienna by bellowing from the door, "If there's anyone here I haven't insulted, I apologize." Among the reasons for Brahms's legendary surliness was the curse. An article written by the great Robert Schumann when Brahms was but a blonde, slim, and beardless lad of 20, in which Schumann praised the virtually unknown Johannes Brahms to the heavens, declaring him to be the new messiah of German music. From that moment on, Brahms had to work twice as hard as he might otherwise have had to work in order to justify Schumann's reckless extravagance. Schumann's article brought Brahms much too much attention, much too soon. And as a result, Brahms made a conscious decision not to compose, or at least not to release, any music that would bring him into direct competition with Beethoven, particularly symphonies. Well into the 1870s, 20 years after the publication of The Curse, Brahms would tell anyone who'd listen that, "I'll never write a symphony. You have no idea how it feels always hearing a giant like Beethoven behind us." Okay, he was lying. Symphony No. 1, in C minor. Yes, in reality, Brahms had been carting around sketches for a symphony in C minor since 1855. Finally, in August of 1876, after 21 years of starting and stopping, of noodling and futzing, Brahms completed his Symphony No. 1 in C minor. As if to confirm Brahms's very worst fears, his friend, the conductor and pianist Hans von Bülow, immediately dubbed it the 10th, meaning, of course, Beethoven's 10th. Brahms was publicly horrified and secretly thrilled, just as he was when von Bülow announced, quote, "I believe it is not without the intelligence of chance that Bach, Beethoven, and Brahms are in alliteration," unquote. From that moment on, Brahms has been known as one of the three bees, the killer bees, the greatest dead Germans who ever lived. Von Bülow's appraisal of the symphony as the 10th was actually right on target. Like Beethoven's 5th and 9th symphonies, Brahms's 1st is a catharsis piece. It begins in the darkness of minor and concludes in ecstatic triumph in major. Here's how the symphony begins, dark and throbbing, in the key of C minor. Thank you. And here's how the symphony ends, roughly 45 minutes later, joyfully and triumphantly in C major. Everything about Brahms' first symphony is Beethoven's ninth-like in conception, from his monumental use of the orchestra to the chorale-like theme of the final movement, a theme so alike the Ode to Joy theme of Beethoven's ninth that Brahms, tired of having the resemblance pointed out to him, could only snap in exasperation, "Yes, and still more striking is that any jackass can see that." Here is Brahms' chorale theme from the fourth movement of his first symphony. Let's trace the large-scale dramatic progression of the symphony as it moves from funereal darkness to triumph. Movement 1. Following the throbbing dirge-like introduction that begins this first movement, a dark and dramatic principal theme explodes from the strings. This first movement is characterized by extreme contrasts, which creates the dramatic effect of struggle, a struggle against the darkness represented by the introduction and the principal theme. It is a struggle partially won. The movement concludes with a quiet return to the introductory material, and even as the horns and timpani continue to play thrumming, funeral-like music, the mode shifts from dark to light, from minor to major. Movement 2. Rather than supply a lyric second movement of respite from the dramatic rigors of the first movement, Brahms's second movement is instead a deeply passionate response to the struggle that was the first movement. Let's hear the lyric climax of this second movement, a passage that features a solo violin. Movement 3 is a gracious, dancing, almost serenade-like movement, a lyric interlude before the struggle resumes in the monumental fourth movement. Here's the conclusion of the third movement, the music that sets up the fourth movement finale. Movement 4. Like Beethoven's symphonic finales, the fourth movement of Brahms's first is a summation of everything that has gone before it. The opening of this fourth movement brings back the mood of darkness and foreboding that began the symphony in the first movement. This dark-hued music eventually gives way to a horn melody, an Alpenhorn or Alps horn theme in the key of C major. After the stormy music that precedes it, this Alpenhorn theme has the effect of the sun breaking through the clouds. Here it is, played by the first and second horns. Capping off this extraordinary shift from minor to major, from darkness to light, Brahms brings in the trombones for the very first time in the symphony, playing a hymn of thanksgiving. The Alpenhorn melody returns, and then apotheosis. The chorale theme makes its revelatory first appearance. Brahms wanted this theme to contain within it all the nobility and purity he could muster, and in this he succeeded brilliantly. Here we go. The Alpenhorn theme, followed by the trombone hymn of thanksgiving, a reprise of the Alpenhorn theme, and finally, the chorale theme. From here on out, it's just one fantastic climax after the next. It took him a while, but Brahms' first symphony was well worth the wait. Thank you.